This is an anechoic chamber, arguably one of the quietest places in the world. I've come here today to escape the noise and to reflect on the nature of sound in the absence of sound. But even in this room, specially designed for silence, I can still hear myself breathing and the occasional stomach growl from my friend Zeb, who's filming me right now. Unlike my sense of vision, I can't close my ear lids and stop perceiving sounds. Every day, my ears are flooded with different sound waves, and my auditory system is remarkably good at identifying most of them. So is yours. Computers are a different story. Your phone, your laptop, your smart home speaker, these things can't tell the difference between a cat and a washing machine. However, things are starting to change, thanks to engineers and researchers who are teaching machines how to hear.
Music audio analysis and speech recognition goes back a very long way. But the idea of recognizing other kinds of sounds is less obvious, less urgent. I really love the idea of the computer being able to produce this gloss. Here's this piece of soundtrack, you want to know what's in it, it'll tell you what's in it in a few words. It'll summarize it, it'll figure out what the most significant parts, what the salient parts are. The idea of a machine that can pull that kind of information out of a signal like that is just very exciting to me. When we've reached that, then we've really done something that the computer is able to do a perception task, to really listen like a person listens.
What would it mean to hear as people do? It might mean to distinguish between environmental sounds, speech, and music, to be able to identify the source and location of these sounds, as well as determine which are noteworthy in a given context.
You might be surprised sometimes at sounds you wouldn't normally notice if you just stop and listen. You know what it is, you know where it is, or maybe you don't know what it is, but at least you know where it is.
Achieving this level of sonic acuity in a machine, though, is a really complex problem.
Why not? Why can't Google Home tell you, you know, did my oven's buzzer go off, or did someone ring the doorbell, or did you hear the dog go by?
Sound sources can add and interfere with each other. As a human, we're very, very good at hearing multiple things going on at the same time. But from a computational level, we don't really understand how that process works deeply enough yet.
Unlike machines, our own sense of hearing has had the benefit of being fine-tuned over millions of years of evolution. But if you take away our sense of vision, even we can be easily fooled. Do you hear an egg frying or rain falling? Dog paws or paper clips? Horse hooves or coconuts?
And Foley artists take advantage of that by using fake sounds, like they shake a piece of cardboard if they want thunder, and who's to say that's not thunder?
In the visual world, there's also ambiguity, but machine learning systems trained on small mountains of data have learned to recognize the differences between various objects, even very subtle differences.
It became clear that there was an opportunity for combining modern methods of machine learning, which are developing very rapidly, with knowledge about how the hearing system works and how signal processing works.
To get started, the team needed to create a set of training data, sourcing millions of sound examples. But first, they needed to decide what sounds exactly were they looking for.
It was a really difficult problem. There wasn't anything like a sensible set of sound things.
So what we did was we hand-designed an ontology. Dan Ellis, the leader of the team, designed a set of 600 classes in a hierarchy that he, along with others, felt was a great representation of the kinds of sounds that people and users care most about.
The principle we came up with was like, we're trying to get to something which is going to reproduce the description that an average listener would be able to do. The idea is if it's something that only an expert can really distinguish, then we don't want to go there. Like, what is the difference between a lute and a zither? And,
you know, it's... I don't know that one.
No, exactly. You're like, oh, let me check Wikipedia.
The ontology organizes sounds into seven main categories. Human sounds, animal sounds, natural sounds, background sounds, music, sounds of things, and source ambiguous sounds, like onomatopoeia words, zip and swoosh.
Okay, so then we had this list of all these words, and then because it's this deep learning scenario, we need labeled data, we need examples.
But the question was where to find them, because while there's a ton of different sound libraries out there with thousands and thousands of different sound effects, they're almost too good, too perfect. The worry is, if you were to train a system with those as examples, it would never learn to recognize the less perfectly captured sounds that we all encounter all the time.
With YouTube, we have all this data that's just real world sounds. So that was the idea. That's like, okay, let's build something that you can play it, the soundtrack of some arbitrary YouTube video, and it'll tell you what's in it.
The only downside, sounds on YouTube are rarely labeled.
People don't put up their YouTube video and say, great tinkling sound or something. And so we'd had to sort of guess.
We got millions of 10-second clips that we believed were moderately likely to be those classes. And then we sent those out to human labelers and had them listen to 10-second audio clips and say, we think it's this sound. Is it actually this sound or not? And so that gave us a set of label data. Sometimes we had to remove things from the set because we just couldn't find the examples of them. There were things that we thought might be good, but then we just couldn't get any data from them.
It's hard to find a good clunk.
Clunk, take four, mark.
Although we do have a very large number of fart sounds.
Just like that's in a lot of YouTube videos.
Yes, and it was easy to find and easy to label.
The audio set consists of more than 2 million labeled sounds or almost 6,000 hours of audio. But counter to what you might think, instead of giving the neural net these audio files, what it's actually getting as input is something like this. A spectrogram representing the frequency of sound over time.
At the very most basic level, what we're trying to do is we're trying to take moderate-sized pictures, like say 1 second of a spectrogram, and we're trying to build a neural network that takes that picture as input and says what the sound is, you know, gives a classification system as output.
I didn't know that it was more of a vision-based use of machine learning.
We do take a lot of inspiration from the vision work here, partially because vision networks have had so much work put into them. There's been thousands and thousands of person years on developing good networks for computer vision. And like we said, the spectrogram is a two-dimensional picture.
We're converting a sound problem into an image problem, and that doesn't seem to be particularly insightful. But it's working so well. And so now we have this classifier which knows about 527 different sound categories, and you can run any soundtrack through it, and every tenth of a second it'll give you a weight of what it thinks is present in that sound.
We're very, very good when there's kind of one dominant sound, and it's a sound we've seen a lot. We can definitely tell you when a ukulele is playing. We're awesome at trumpet. Dogs barking, we're quite good at.
A dog sounds like this.
You know, it does these really magical things. We'll look at these videos like, oh, I got the ticking of the clock in the background. And it's like, wait, why does it say honk there? And it's like, you listen to it, and it's like, oh yeah, there's something which sounds just like a goose. But there are other times it's like, why is it not saying anything's going on here? It's learned something, it's got some examples, but it doesn't have the full breadth of, yeah.
We have the horns in the background. It's always a fun thing about filming is it's a very sound-based thing as well.
Yeah. I didn't even hear that.
The challenges are getting the timing right, dealing with interruptions, dealing with multiple sounds at once.
As this research continues to improve, there are many possible applications, like making YouTube videos more accessible.
We actually do automatically now surface laughter and applause and whether there's music or not in the video. And those are now shown in YouTube captions for the hearing impaired, which I think is super cool.
The sound understanding team is also beginning to work with outside groups, helping their conservation efforts by using acoustic monitoring.
Like knowing when to shut down a wind farm if there's a big flock of egrets coming by low or something like that, or monitoring whales and dolphins to figure out if some ship needs to slow down or turn.
And in addition to recognizing sounds, the team is also exploring ways to say where sounds are coming from.
Here's a demonstration of multi-speaker localization and tracking. I'm the only one talking right now, so the bright spot is over on the right side of the screen and it's pointing at me.
If I start talking, the localizer would detect me instead.
And if I start talking and Envy continues talking, it'll track both of us, and even if I move around, I come towards the center, and then walk off to the left, it'll still follow me.
Sound understanding research could also lead to new ways to enhance audio recordings, create better hearing aids, and my personal favorite, help me find my favorite sounds in the videos that I've taken. For example, I love the weird muffled barks that my dog makes while she's sleeping, and I'd love to just be able to search bark on my phone and find all the videos I've ever taken of her making those sounds. Making this video definitely made me hear the world a little differently, and I hope that it did for you as well. So thanks for watching, and if you want to do some more listening, I have a couple of options for you. In this video description is a link to the audio set that the sound understanding team at Google published if you want to check it out for yourself. And you may have noticed some people throughout this video filming and recording sounds. Those are my friends Dan, Matt, and Zach from Flies Collective, and I thought that the sounds that we recorded together were really beautiful and interesting to listen to on their own. So I've made this bonus video of all the sounds that we recorded together that you can listen to as well. All right, thanks for watching. Bye!